My name's Karen Mann. I'm with the City of Red Deer Emergency Services. I feel really lucky that I followed on the presenter ahead of me because he sort of segued nicely into everything I was going to say. So for those of you who don't know what emergency management is, emergency management is a four-phase process. So we look at things from the entire cycle. So from mitigation all the way through to recovery. Mitigation being the process of reducing or eliminating a hazard wherever possible. So if we have the opportunity to take a hazard and remove it, or reduce or eliminate the impacts from that hazard, that would be mitigation, and we try to do that wherever possible. Mitigation falls into two areas, both structural and non-structural mitigation. A lot of times we think about the structural things, like in Winnipeg, they built a huge diversion project to make sure that they didn't flood downtown Winnipeg every other year. But there are non-structural mitigation measures that we take, such as land zoning. It's a really good example. We don't zone land in areas we know are going to flood, or at least we shouldn't, or we try not to. So those are non-structural mitigation measures. Preparedness, previous presenter spoke a little bit about preparedness. Response, obviously, when something happens and we can't mitigate it, we are required to respond to it. And then finally, recovery. Sometimes recovery is an overlooked process. Based on the speakers you've had today, I don't think you're overlooking recovery at all. I think you realize that, especially when it comes to things like hydrocarbon releases or impacts to environments, the recovery process tends to be the vast majority of this cycle, because your response might be a day, 10 days, 100 days, but that recovery process may be years or decades from an environmental perspective. So when we look at things, we look at it on a cyclical scale. Roles and responsibilities of local authorities. So I don't know where everybody's from, but all local authorities, no matter how big they are, where they are, what kind of governance they have, there's legislation in the province that tells us that all local authorities are responsible for ensuring that we can respond to and recover from emergencies that occur within our boundaries. We don't have the ability as a municipality, as much as sometimes we'd like to, we don't have the ability to just say, oh, you know, that spill that happened on the river, we're just going to walk away from that and just let somebody else deal with it. We don't have that ability. Legally, we're required to respond. So how do we do that? Well, we have a whole bunch of committees. and the reason I put this slide in here is because all communities are required to have emergency management committees, emergency management agencies. They're required to appoint a director of emergency management. So if you're looking for somebody, when you go back to your community or your municipality, you're looking for somebody to ask all of these important emergency related questions, ask to speak to your director of emergency management. Smaller communities, it tends to be your reeve, or you know, your deputy mayor, or a director of community services or development services. It could be, there's not a lot of communities that have full-time directors of emergency management. I think there's probably less than 20 in Alberta. But that's definitely something to keep in mind, is that you're all required to have plans, and that doesn't matter what the hazard is. Doesn't matter if you're having a flood, a forest fire, an explosion, a spill, the municipality is required to be able to respond to that in some way, shape, or form. And they have to be able to use all their resources. We're required to basically expend all available resources at our disposal in responding to and recovering from that emergency. That's an expectation of us through government. So this is more from the business side. When we talk about impacts from hazards, a lot of times we don't see the big picture. We think, well, you know, a flood is going to cause, you know, damage to property. But when we damage properties and we damage businesses, there's all these additional impacts that include workforce reductions, suppliers, supply chain issues, changes to the demand for your service, which in critical utilities is definitely one we see a lot of during emergencies. Impacts to essential services like power, water, sewer, things like that. Limited access to systems, technology, and communications. we all are reliant on communication. We're all expecting our cell phones and our phones and our internet to work all the time. Truth of the matter is, during emergencies, there could very well be impacts to these systems. We also need to be aware of the extraordinary needs of our employees. So emergencies that happen in municipalities, we have a number of roles. First of all, we have to continue to provide our services under differing conditions to our residents. So we try to limit or eliminate impacts to our service provision, especially in critical services like water. We also have a continuity issue. So we might lose our own buildings, we may lose our own people, we might have impacts to our infrastructure that we rely on to provide those aforementioned services. And the other one is that we're also residents of our own communities. So the people that you're relying on to respond to your emergency may also be the people whose house just got flooded or who just got evacuated and sent to a reception center. So there's this sort of triad of responsibility at the municipal level, and I think it's really important that you take these things into consideration. Hazard has multiple levels, and it has multiple levels of magnitude and severity. Not all hazards exist in all communities. But unfortunately for all of you, some hazards exist everywhere. So the hazards that exist in Edmonton or Calgary might be different than those in Red Deer, but we all have hazard, and therefore we're all required to have emergency plans. Why is it important? I'm looking at impacts to businesses. A lot of times when I do presentations like this, kind of get people, I used to get a lot more of it actually, I found, when people used to kind of like nod off, like nothing ever happens here. We're never going to have this happen. This is completely, you know, doom and gloom. I think all these people from the examples up here, that's a gas pump in New Jersey from Hurricane Sandy. This is 3 weeks after the hurricane actually hit, and they still have no fuel. The Shaw fire was a really, really good example of continuity of systems. A lot of people don't know where their information is stored. A lot of systems that had nothing to do with Shaw just happened to be lodged in that building, right? So we need to be aware of these things ahead of time. So when we hear about a fire at the Shaw building in downtown Calgary, we know whether there's an impact to us or not. People couldn't register their vehicles because that's where that information was stored, was in a hub at that Shaw building. The bottom left is a pretty famous picture, I guess, now in Alberta. That's actually the town hall. It was pretty much a brand new building in Slave Lake when it burned down. From an emergency management perspective, we always have emergency operations centers. We're really proud of our emergency plans. We tell everybody, if we have an emergency, we're going to operate centrally from our emergency operations center. And our emergency operations center is at City Hall, in case anybody's looking for us. That's where we are in the city of Red Deer. Slave Lake, same thing. Town Hall is a likely place for your emergency operations center. When it burns down, when you're in it, that's a whole other ball of wax, right? So that's that triad I was talking about. You could lose your own building. And then the last one is actually from the blackout in 2003 in Toronto, if anybody remembers that. My brother was flying into Toronto that day, I remember, to start university, and there was a whole issue of could they fly, could they not fly, was the airport open, was it not open, and it ebbed and flowed throughout the day. So the questions I always want people to ask themselves are we vulnerable, and how can we make ourselves more resilient? So emergency managers, municipalities, fire departments, utilities should all be looking at these questions. We should all be saying, how do we increase our resilience and decrease our vulnerability? How do we do that? What does it even mean? Vulnerabilities are things like reliance on technology, same day supply chain, small workforce, specialized skills that only one or two people can do. Is anybody nodding their head at any of these? I did a conference presentation actually for wastewater in Regina about 5 years ago. It was during the first, it was H5, it was between H5N1 and H1N1. And the big question that came up was about chemical delivery for water plants. There were a lot of smaller communities at the time that were stockpiling only a very small quantity of certain chemicals that were required in the water treatment process. And those chemicals came from the United States of America. Now, if you during pandemic planning had anything to do with it, you'll remember there was a lot of concern that if a pandemic were to hit, the borders would close and the United States and Canada would sort of close up shop and keep what we had, right? Makes sense. We're not gonna keep shipping off stuff that we might need here. So that started to become a really big discussion. And people started thinking, if we've got a week of supply now, maybe we need 4 weeks of supply. What's realistic? And there's always that cost and risk management balance that you're trying to strike. It's not reasonable in terms of storage and cost to have 100 years of supply for these chemicals, but it might be reasonable to have 6 weeks instead of one. Points of failure, financial limitations, interrelated systems, aging infrastructure, and the presence of hazards. So some communities flood a lot. I think my friends in the south or places up north where they have, you know, the concern about river breakup in Fort McMurray every year. So they get really good at responding to river breakup. When you're in a community where it doesn't happen very often, you tend to develop a little bit of complacency. The next question is, are we resilient, or how can we make ourselves more resilient? So basically that list I just had, if you can eliminate all those things, you're gonna be more resilient. So resilient communities have a lot more capacity. We measure things that are both tangible and less tangible. So the presence of emergency plans, the presence of strong emergency management systems, emergency services, those are sort of the more tangible things. The age of infrastructure is more tangible. So if you have a good plan for modernizing and upgrading your infrastructure on a regular basis, if you have fallback plans for continuity issues, these are all things that contribute to resilience that we can measure. There's other things that as communities we look at that increase resilience, like volunteerism, community spirit, are the awareness of people, of their neighbors. These are all things that are harder to measure, but actually increase the resilience of a community overall. So in conclusion, some planning is always better than no planning. So a lot of times people go like this, they're like, we don't have the resources, we don't have the people, we don't have the time, we don't have the money to do any planning. Well, I'm with you, don't worry. it is a process, but the hardest part is starting that process. And if you go back to my second slide, I just remind everybody in the room that there is a legislated responsibility for emergency management in this province. And so if you're working within a municipality that you haven't heard of their emergency plans, or you've never talked to them about it, or nobody's ever brought it to your attention or included you in those process, that might be a good place to start, is going and finding those directors of emergency management, talking to your city manager, your town manager about your emergency management processes, and then seeing where you fit in and whether you can add value to those processes. Increasing continuity and decreasing vulnerability does not have to be expensive. So using what you have, leveraging the planning that's already in place, working with your municipalities in neighboring areas to do joint planning, sometimes especially with small, smaller areas, counties, small villages, things like that, we see a lot of joint planning, or what we call regional planning. And preparedness and continuity are not simply plans on a shelf. They're ongoing processes that include everyone in the organization. So when you bring in new staff, inform them of your emergency procedures. And like the speaker before me was saying, we also need to exercise these things so that we know whether they work or not. Because luckily for us, we don't have a spill every single day. So it could be years and years and years and years, and we may never in our career get to use these plans. So that doesn't mean it's never gonna happen. Just means we've been lucky and we've kind of dodged a bunch of bullets over the years. So making sure that this is a part of your orientation for new staff is always an important thing as well. And then when you have an event, you want to look at what you did and you want to do that debrief and say, what worked, what didn't, how can we improve so that we are better next time? And then finally, I guess the final comment I have is that resilience is worth it. Every hour, every minute that a system is not operational, it's costing people money. So if you're looking at the private sector, that's how they measure these things. They look at it and they say, closing downtown Calgary for 6 hours due to wind is costing us $1 million a minute. Up to $1 million a minute for being closed. That's a lot of money. So if you have plans and processes in place to recover quicker, I'm sure if you put it in dollars and cents, a lot of people are going to start talking that language, right? That's how you, I find that's a really good way to get leverage for these things, is by saying, yes, it costs money here, but it will cost us more money if we don't do it down here. So the costs associated with increasing resilience are usually, or almost always, I would go out on a limb and say, a lot less than expanded recovery and response costs. And doing response and recovery in the absence of planning, there tends to be wasted resources, wasted time, and that costs money as well. And it also can put the environment, property, systems, people at risk. And with that, I guess that's my presentation. This is a funny slide. I think it's funny. It's like a continuity joke, but this is actually a real sign from during the blackout in New York City. A lot of businesses couldn't really serve food because they didn't have gas and they didn't have electricity, but they had ice somehow, and they were serving beer and wine, and people were sitting on the patio drinking beer and wine in the dark, and that business stayed open because they found a way to stay open. That was their plan. Can't serve everything, but we're gonna stay open. And if you have any questions, my information's up there, but I urge you to get in contact with your emergency management and fire services people when you get back to your community and talk about a lot of these emergency management, emergency planning issues.